I don't know why I feel that I must confess this thing to you. Perhaps it's because you're supposed to be objective. After all, I don't know you, and you don't know me. We've not spoken before, and it may be that we will never speak again. For now, we have nothing in common except words and silence. Lately, I find myself thinking a lot about silence. There's an edge to it now. Constant threat of disruption. I keep waiting to hear those sounds again. The lifting of the piano lid. The notes rising from the vibration of the strings. The muffled echo of a false key being struck. I find myself waking in the darkest spell of the night just to listen. But there's only silence. It was not always this way. I recall David waking me on that final night. The night I'd tried to destroy the thing that was luring my little boy away from me. I remember the fear in his voice, the trembling of his lip, the feel of his small hand upon mine. "Daddy," he whispered, "Daddy, listen." And I listened, and I heard the first notes rising from the piano. "Daddy, he's back," said David. "The little ghost boy, he's back." Audrey and Jason died on August 25th, 1998. Audrey was 35, Jason was 8, just 1 year older than his brother David. They died because a truck driver swerved to avoid a fox while he was coming around a bend, only a mile or two from our home. It was a stupid thing to do, but looking back, understandable. He ran straight into their car, and they were killed instantly. About a month ago, a new posting came up. I really had no choice but to go. It was temporary, just a year, maybe a little longer, but I thought that it might help. I mean, every day on his way to school, David had to pass the place where they died. So did I. I thought that taking a break from it all might be good for both of us. But it wasn't, of course. David's nightmares began about a week after we arrived at the new house, or rather the old house, where it was a little dilapidated. The company was paying for some refurbishments, and a local man named Frank Harris had been working on it for some time before we arrived, but it was still a dark, claustrophobic place. It gave David bad dreams, so it seemed. The first time it happened, I woke in darkness to hear the piano being played in the living room, the strains of a Chopin nocturne ascending from below. The agency responsible for the house had left a lot of the original furniture in place, including the piano. I got up and went downstairs to find David standing in the room, alone. I thought that he might have been sleepwalking, but he was awake. He was always awake when it happened. I'd heard him talking to himself as I descended, but he stopped as soon as I stepped into the room. Still, I caught snatches of it, mainly yes and no, as if somebody was asking him questions and he was giving out answers in return. He talked the way he talked to people he didn't know very well or of whom he was shy or wary. But the one-sided conversation wasn't the strangest part of it. It was the piano playing that was so strange. You see, David never played the piano. It was Jason, his lost brother, who played. David didn't have a note in his head. That morning over breakfast, I asked David what he saw when he was in the room. "A little boy," David said. "I see a little boy. He has dark hair and blue eyes, and he's older than me, but only a little. He talks to me. He asks me to come and play with him. Sometimes he asks me to sit beside him at the piano and help him finish a song. Then he says we'll go away and play together, but I never go to him." "Why, David," I asked, "why won't you play?" "Because I'm afraid of him," said David. "He looks like a boy, but he acts older." "David," I asked, "does he look like Jason?" David's face froze as he looked at me. "Jason's dead," he replied. "He died with Mum in the crash." "Would you miss him?" He nodded. "I miss him a lot. But the little boy isn't Jason. He looks like him sometimes. But it isn't Jason. I wouldn't be frightened of Jason." With that, he stood and placed his cereal bowl in the sink. He stayed at the sink for a time, then turned to me as if he had decided something. "Dad," he said, "Mr. Harris says that something bad happened in this house. Is that true?" "I don't know, David," I replied, and it was the truth. Mr. Harris said that you have to be careful with some places, David continued. He says they have long memories, that the stones hold memories, and sometimes, without meaning to, people can make them come alive again. I tried to keep the anger from my voice as I spoke. Mr. Harris is employed as a gardener and a handyman, David, not as a professional frightener. I'm going to have a word with him. Now you'd better be off to school. With that, David nodded unhappily, picked up his coat and school bag from the hallway, and walked down the garden path to wait for the school bus. I was about to join him when I saw another figure kneeling beside him, obviously talking to David, his face serious and concerned. He was an elderly man with silver hair, and there were paint stains on his blue overalls. It was Frank Harris, and I felt that hurt bubble up inside me once again. He stood and patted David's head gently, then waited until the school bus pulled up and whisked David away before turning and heading up the path towards the house. I intercepted Mr. Harris as he opened the front door with his spare key. He looked a little startled, then confused, as I asked him to follow me into the kitchen. "I'm afraid that I have to talk to you about a serious matter, Mr. Harris," I said. "It's these stories you've been telling David about the house. You know, he's been having nightmares, and you may be the cause of them. I really don't think you should be discussing such things with him." Mr. Harris regarded me evenly. "All I told your son was that he should be careful. All older houses have histories, some good, some bad. As new people enter them and bring new life to them, the history of the house is altered and modified. That way, bad histories can slowly, over time, become good histories. It's the way of things. But the house where you live now, Mr. Markham, hasn't had that kind of change. It hasn't had time." Now it was my turn to look confused. "I don't understand," I said. "Your company rented that property for you without checking on its history," said Harris. "It was just in the right area at the right price, and the agent was so happy to rent it, he didn't see any point in spoiling a good deal by opening his mouth. Nobody from around these parts would ever have considered renting or buying this house, or even recommending it to a non-local. In fact, I was the only person who would agree to work on it. It's not a good house in which to be raising a child, Mr. Markham. It's not good to allow a child to live its life in a house where another child had its life ended." "A child died in the house?" "A child was killed in the house," he corrected me, 30 years ago this November. "A man named Victor Parks lived here, and he killed a local child in his bedroom. The police caught him trying to bury the remains down by the river." "Lord," I said, "I'm sorry, I didn't know. I never even heard of Victor Parks." "Nobody told you, Mr. Markham, so you couldn't have known," continued Harris. "By the time you'd rented the house, it was already too late. As for Parks, he's dead. He had a heart attack in his cell on the very night he was sentenced to life imprisonment. There were those who said that he couldn't bear to be separated from the house. He lived there all his life, and the house had been in his family for 2 generations before that. Maybe the thought of life in a small cell far away from what was familiar to him was too much for him to bear." Something changed in his voice. It tightened as if fighting off some familiar or unwanted emotion. "He was an unusual man, Victor Parks," he said. "He worked as a verger in the church. He served in the local council. Many ways he was a model citizen, and people trusted him. They trusted him with their children." He paused, and those old eyes were filled with the remembered grief as they stared back into the past. What he said next made my stomach lurch and caused my hands to tense involuntarily. "He gave piano lessons, Mr. Markham. He taught piano to the children." Mr. Harris sighed gently, then bent down to pick up his paintpot. "There's one more thing you should know, Mr. Markham," he said as he stood. "David says he sees a little boy. But Parks didn't kill a boy. He killed a girl. Whatever your son is seeing, Mr. Markham, it's not the ghost of that dead child." I stood aside to let him pass, and the next question came so unexpectedly that I thought for a moment an unseen third person had asked it. "What was her name, Mr. Harris, the name of the girl who died here?" But even as the words left my lips, I already seemed to know part of the answer, and I understood at last why it was that he had agreed to do the work on the house. "Lucy," he replied. "Her name was Lucy Harris." That night David came to me for the final time and woke me to listen to the sound of the piano. Again I heard the nocturne being played, expert fingers drawing the notes from the keys. "It's him," whispered David. I could see his tears glistening even in the darkness. "That's the music he always plays. He wants me to follow him into the dark place, but I don't want to go. I'm going to tell him to go away. I'm going to tell him to go away forever. With that he turned and ran from the room. I leaped from my bed and followed him, calling on him to stop. But he was already racing down the stairs. Before my bare foot even hit the first step, he was entering the living room, following the sound of the piano, and seconds later I heard his voice raised, and a second voice answered. When I reached the bottom of the stairs and stared into the living room, there was a little boy seated on the piano stool. It looked like Jason, except it wasn't him. All of the good in Jason, all of the brightness, just wasn't there. Instead, there was the shell of a boy who might once have been mine, and something dark moved inside him. He wore the same t-shirt and shorts that Jason had been wearing on the day he died, except they didn't quite fit, they looked too tight, and there was dirt and blood on them. And the voice, it wasn't a child's voice. It was a man's voice, deep and threatening. It sounded obscene, coming out of a small boy. It said, "Play with me, David. Come sit beside me. Help me finish my piece. Then I'll show you my special place, my dark place. Come to me, David, and we can play together forever." I stepped into the room, and the spectre looked at me. As it did so, it changed, as if by distracting it I had somehow broken its concentration. Its form shimmered and rippled like the reflection in a pool distorted by the impact of a stone, and when the disturbance ceased, it was no longer a boy. It was no longer anything human. Instead, the thing was old and stooped and decayed, with a hairless skull and pinched white skin. Yellow teeth were revealed as it raised its hand to its mouth and licked its fingers with the remains of its tongue. The shreds of dark soot hung on what was left of its body, and its eyes were black and lusting. I grabbed David and pushed him behind me back into the hallway. I could hear him crying. The thing smiled at me and touched itself as it did so, and I knew what I had to do. There was a sledgehammer in the hallway. Harris had left it there. I reached for it, my eyes never leaving the thing on the piano stool. It was already fading away when I took the first swing, and I saw the hammer pass through it as I hit the piano. I struck at the wood and the ivory again and again and again, screaming and howling as I did so. I kept swinging the hammer until most of the piano lay in pieces on the ground, and my feet bled from the impact of the splinters. Then I took the remains outside, and in the darkness I burned them. David helped me. We stood in the still night air, and we watched them burn. And I thought at one point that I saw a figure twisting in the flames, a figure in a dark suit slowly burning, its mouth wide in agony as it turned to smoke. Now it is I who have the nightmares, and I who lie awake listening in the dead of night. And in my dreams I see a thing with hungry eyes luring children into dark places, and I hear the sound of music playing. I hear a nocturne. I call to the children. I try to stop them. Sometimes Mr. Harris is with me, and we try to warn them together. Sometimes they listen to us. Sometimes they listen to him.